This is Tim Nash. He is a security expert in 24SP. Works with daily, which we heard before, talk about how to make your websites faster. And Tim is going to talk about workflow, which is my understanding.
Let's just check. Who came for a security talk? Okay. Other room, go see Nigel. He's one of the Q&A panel. Asking really complicated questions. If you don't know any complicated questions, you can spend 5 minutes coming up with something to ask him. That's my handle at TNash on Twitter. Feel free to tweet sarcastic things to me. Normally, when you do a talk, the best way to start is with a cunning story that will hook your audience in and make them get engaged with you. But this entire talk is basically ego-driven and all about me. So we'll start with me. That's my finger pointing at some hardware in a data center in Manchester. My name's Tim. I'm the WordPress platform lead at 34SP. As it's probably been mentioned a couple of times, I do loads of stuff with security. I'm a former pen tester. I co-run WordPress leads, and I've been involved with WordPress for a long time. I used to run a small dev agency, and I go around the country speaking about security. This is why I'm here, talking about productivity. So if I accidentally start saying scary stories, I'm really sorry, it's just the normal pattern. So why am I talking about productivity? Well, mainly because they didn't accept the security talk, obviously. But productivity and being able to find more time, I describe it as, it's not about efficiency, it's optimization. I'm not looking to make myself better. I mean, it's a good thing for humans to strive to make themselves better, but I'm quite okay with being okay. But what I need is more time. This isn't going to be a talk about too much about self-help, though, and I'm not going to sit here and tell you to go do yoga or meditation, though meditation is useful, and I recommend the calm app if you are going to, and it's something I have done. But it's a few years ago, if I started talking about the things I'm going to talk about today, I would have started looking like this. And I've mellowed over the years. And as I've mellowed, I've slowed down. Now I'm just lazy. And about a year and a half to maybe 3 years ago, I realized I was getting very lazy. And I had quite a lot of projects that were just drifting away. I was starting lots of things, but I wasn't necessarily finishing them. And that was both in my professional life and my home life. I'm a tinkerer by trade. I like to fiddle and fix things. I like working with my hands as well as working on computers. My house is lovely in home automation, and I'm currently in the process of working with builders to build a new house. There's lots of stuff going on in my life, and I need more time. Now, I spent a little bit of time making a time machine, and it didn't work. Now I need even more time, so I'm going to have to work out where I'm going to get it. Because I want to spend more time with my family. This is the point you go, ah. Thank you. But I do. I need to spend more time with my family. Before I'm slightly concerned my daughter is going to start asking questions like, who is that man? But that's only because I cut my beard down. So the rest of this talk is basically about how I've gone from not being able to do much to doing more things. And I'm not perfect in any way. Any of the tips and tricks may work for you, they may not. But hopefully there'll be something in here for all of you. It's not going to go particularly dev-focused, but I'm going to talk about some tools and stuff that I use in my work life, as well as stuff that's outside of my work life. And the critical thing, and the thing that's really changed for me, is planning. As in, I do some now. Historically, my way of doing things was wake up, wait till someone told me to do something, do it. Especially at work, I would, my working plan, lots of projects would be going on, but I basically prioritised based on who was screaming at me the most. it's a very effective strategy, because that way you feel like you're always achieving. Because the person who stops screaming, that's success. It might not be doing you any good, and you end up just running and always firefighting. So I've started to learn to plan. I have a small child, and she screams a lot, so at home this meant nothing ever got done because we were pandering. Pandering? That's the word. No, pandering to the small child who was screaming constantly and trying to fix her problems, so we were never doing anything else. So planning doesn't just mean planning at work, it means planning at home as well, and making sure we're carving out different activities and times. So I can't add hours, and as we've seen, I actually need to somehow use less of them. Because 2.5 years ago, I was sleeping 4 hours a night. Now, good news, I had it was over 20 hours. Bad news, you can't do that. Some people can, but most humans, we can't. Bad things happen to you slowly over time, especially when you're doing 24-hour shifts going along and then doing an 8-hour catch-up 2 days every row. It just doesn't work. So, step one, very simple, measure tasks. By measuring tasks, I mean measure everything. Try and work out whenever you do something, even if you don't do it over time, if you're doing it for your first time, I've got a new task. I need to do a presentation. Start timer. Work out how long does it take me to do a presentation. Put it all together. About 14 hours. Which is quite a lot. Write a blog post. About 5 hours from doing about 4,000 words. Once you know exactly how much time it's going to take you to do a different thing, you can actually plan it. Otherwise, we're guessing. We're rubbish at guessing. Humans have no real concept of time, which is ironic given it's completely artificial and it's something that we made up. We should at least be good at guessing it ourselves. So when it comes to doing any sort of estimate, either follow our technical director's advice and go with the rule of pi. Whatever you've decided is the amount of estimate you're going to use, times it by pi. And that will give you roughly where you should be. If you're talking to a client, double that. Because it's way better to finish the project in half the time and look really good than it is to overrun. It's scary how accurate the rule of pi is. It's also worth emphasising there is no such thing as a 5-second job. There is no such thing as a 5-minute job. In fact, if you've started to use the word 5 in here, it doesn't going to take that long. But 5-second jobs are nearly always the things that are going to destroy you. It sounds weird, this idea that you're going to do a lot of planning and forward thinking. But I plan everything, and I find that my mood and my personality can lead me down dark rabbit holes, and sometimes they can lead me down rabbit holes where I cannot get out of bed. Then, those days, I absolutely schedule everything. And everything goes on a to-do list, and I work my way through my to-do lists. Every day, I have a to-do list, and I will work my way through them. I prioritise things, I go through. There are different mechanisms for doing prioritisation. I like the one that is eat that frog, which basically says, take the hardest task you're going to do, do it first, everything after is going to be easy. I modify it slightly by taking a very, very easy task that has to be as easy as press a button. If it's any more complicated than that, it has to go down the priority list. But if I've got a task that I can press that button and have a win, take that, but otherwise eat that frog. As you're going through and doing your tasks and working your way through, and when I say I put everything on a to-do list, I've got two sets of to-do lists. I've got my Tim's okay to-do list and Tim's in a bad place to-do list. And Tim's okay to-do list has big, broad things on it. Build a house. No, that's literally on my to-do list. It keeps getting dropped down page by page. But on my other one, my very, very shortened version is clean your teeth. Sounds so simple until you're in a scenario where you can't do that. go for an exercise, go do walk, go for a walk, etc., etc. Once you've started understanding your to-do list and P3, you have to realize, and you're looking at how much you measure your time, you need to understand what distracts you. Netflix, for example, if you work from home. Chocolate, eating, Twitter, Twitter, Instagram, Pinterest, that blog post I just saw over there. Pretty much anything on the internet, which is really awkward if you work on the internet. To the point that, you know, one of the exchanges between me and my wife is, you coming to bed? No, I got distracted. What by? The internet. Again. Know your distractions, work out what your distractions are, and try and block them out. And I'll give you some tips for how to do that a bit later on. Distractions are things that you cause. They're mental things that you're putting in. Nobody is saying, go to Twitter. Are there any social media managers in here? Sorry, yours comes next, so you get to get a free pass for Twitter. But for the rest of us, no one is saying, go to Twitter, go to Facebook, go to Instagram, do this. That's your brain doing that, and therefore it's a distraction. However, when we're coming to planning, we have another thing, and that's risk. Now, risks are things that are outside of our control, coming along and distracting, and causing our plans to be pushed along. Risks include your boss. When it comes to making sure that your task will not be done on time, your boss is so high on the priority list because, let's face it, they're going to add another 10, 15, 20 tasks for you. Communication mechanisms, Slack, someone coming and talking to you, all of these things are risks to send you off to make sure that your task never gets completed. With distractions, it's very easy to say, block Twitter. It's a lot harder to suggest blocking your boss. I mean, you could try. I'm not sure how well it will go. But even in that, even in an office environment, there's ways around this. Headphones. Which is clearly the universal sign for do not disturb. Right? Yeah? No. Have you ever actually worked in an office and this has worked? Have you ever sat there with headphones on and the person's gone, oh no, that person's got headphones on. Oh, I can't talk to them about this thing. I'll just send them an email. No, they'll still come and tap you on the shoulder. But if you can manage to mitigate and go, okay, I need to do this dedicated piece of work, that means I can turn Slack off, that means I can turn this off, I can tell my boss, actually, I'm going to be working on this, please do not disturb me. Put everything to one side, you can get your work done. Having done all of our project planning ahead of time, and we haven't even done anything yet, the next thing to do, especially with bigger projects, is walk away. I never start the task that I just wrote in my diary. So if I've written something down that I'm going to do something, I don't start it straight away. Because if I start it straight away, I'm enthusiastic. I think, go headlong into it, and I will be all the way in the weeds so very, very quickly. And then I will realize that the weeds are not weeds, they're tentacles. And I'm being slowly but surely consumed and sucked in. Because I didn't think through the consequences of any of my actions because I was too happy going, yay, I'm going to go do this. Whether it's code-fixing something, whether it's making any sort of decision. It doesn't have to walk away for long, but just walk away from the task for a little while so you can think through the consequences of your action. It sounds so counterintuitive. I want to get things done quicker, so I'm telling you to not start them. And this isn't an excuse to not start them. Just, you need to step away, even if it's for 5 minutes, give yourself and your brain a chance to go, huh, oh yeah, if I do this, this, and this, that explodes, and that's bad. Let me not do that. If you can walk away, you'll find yourselves in a position, when you do come to it, that you have, even if it's subconsciously, started working out how things should be done. So what does my day look like? I am a morning person. That probably doesn't shock many people. I wake up about 5 o'clock in the morning. Lots of people just wake up. Mind you, those people probably go to bed at 11 or 12, and I go at you, so it balances out. I like myself in the morning. I'm very productive in the morning. By this time of day, I'm starting to wind down. I'm starting to slow down. Effectively, we are in my evening. 9 o'clock, I turn into a pumpkin. Literally turn into a pumpkin. Maybe a mouse, one of the two. I can't remember which part of the metaphor I'm meant to be with, from a horse or a carriage. But anyway, the general idea is I go to bed. So we are in my afternoon, a late afternoon, and now we're definitely going into my evening. So 5, I get up. My daughter will be up between 5:45 and 6:45. So I have this 45 minutes. It is mine. Nobody else can take these 45 minutes away from me. So what do? Well, clearly I sit in bed, sit on Twitter going, and that's always what I used to do. But now I get up, and it's little simple things. I, for years and years, was dehydrated. I didn't know that, but I just had weird, slightly scaly skin, and I put it down to eczema. Simple thing like that. It's like, go drink water. Really hard to convince me to drink water. I don't know why, but when I got out of bed, I didn't go, I must drink water. I went to the tap and got water. I'd go, I must drink coffee, and go straight downstairs to go and get some coffee. Instead, now, get out of bed, go to the door. By the door, we have a bookshelf. There's a thing of water on it. I now pick up water, drink it on my way out of the door. It sounds like crazy optimization, but all of a sudden, I'm now drinking 500 milliliters of water. Likewise, in your own, whether it's hacking yourself, whether it's your developing skills, whatever you're doing, those sort of micro-optimizations aren't just about speed and efficiency. Yes, I'm no longer going to get the actual tap and turn it on, but because I do this every day, it becomes a routine, it becomes part of it. To the point that there was a thing where for one evening, I wasn't doing my normal bedtime routine. In the morning, I woke up and slammed my hand into the wall because the water bottle wasn't there anymore, and it's 5 in the morning and I'm not awake. Because it wasn't there to grab, I just went straight into the wall. On the plus side, this shows that I had built enough muscle memory and routine in there that this is good. On the other hand, you need to have some sort of feedback and testing system because otherwise the wall gets cut. So I pick up my water, I drink my water, I take my pills. Again, originally I was just taking the water. Get downstairs, have my coffee, think, ha, we take some pills back upstairs. So putting the pills there, down I go. Those 45 minutes of my reading time. I'll explain how I go through my reading routine in a bit, but they're my reading time. Why I struggle to read effectively at any other time of the day. So I take those 45 minutes, and that's peace and tranquility to read. I do a tiny bit of meditation at the beginning, but after that, I just read for those 45 minutes with my cup of coffee. For many of you, that sounds wonderful. Can you imagine just the 45 minutes of your day, you get to have a cup of coffee, you get to read? Do people like that? Or you have to just get up at 5 in the morning? No, and already there's no proof. So we get to 6:45, I can look after kids, etc. I then go to work. Normally, I work, because I commute into Manchester a couple of times a week, I do most of my work daily work on the train. Because when I get to the office, I'm not going to be able to do any work. When I get to the office, what happens is I go in and go, morning, and then half the office goes, well, actually, there's normally only 2 of us in the office at 7:30. But we have a morning, and then by about 9, we've already had Tim, fix this. Did you break this? No. Tim. All through the day. To try and get encourage some work, I managed to convince people not to do meetings with me till 2 o'clock. I think my boss in the States, who very rarely sees me, thinks that's because I'm lazy and I'm not getting into work till 2. So I refuse to schedule in meetings until after 2 o'clock. The reality is, I want that by 2 o'clock, I'm tired. And I'd rather sleep in a meeting than I would actually do it's taking up time before. So I'm doing my meetings 2 o'clock till 4 o'clock, I'm back home. I then get the train journey back. My train journeys have become semi-precious things, but I can't read on a train. So I tend to listen to podcasts and other bits. My days, work from home days, those times become my ultimate productive periods. Because now I've gained back about 1.5 hours in the morning and about 2.5 in the evening. Yep, welcome to our train system, it's shit. Combine those together, I have a fair amount of time that becomes my hobby time, where I get to spend those parts of my day. Then I go off with my parents, with my family, with my kids, get that last hour and a half. She goes to bed at about 7:30, I go to bed at 9. I wake up the next day. My day's pretty easy for me, and I do that 5 o'clock wake up every day, doing Saturday and Sunday. My day's not your day, get your own days. But seriously, I get to carve out that time because it's spare and nobody's using it. Yours might be the complete reverse. You may be able to carve out your evenings. Maybe you're sitting watching TV from 8 o'clock till 9, 10, 11, 12. You're probably unhealthy at this point. 1, 2 in the morning. Maybe some of that can be crept back. So, tools I use for productivity and bits, I keep a diary and I keep a journal. I use a form of bullet journaling, and one thing I would recommend is get a decent notebook. I mean, this is a proper notebook. This isn't my diary, this is just my normal notebook that I carry for writing notes. The cool thing about something like this is that you can normally get ones that you can buy replacement paper inside. And what I do with these notebooks is once I finish writing in them, I put tape around them so they're completely sealed. I do is I used to work doing payment gateway systems. I'd have client details in here that I couldn't allow out, but I probably didn't want to burn. So I'd seal them up and mark them as sealed. And if I ever needed to go into them, I could then open them up and I could keep a record. And I've just kept doing that. But get something that you want to use. He says this is for each book. Get something you want to use. Spend a little bit of money on a decent notebook if you're going to do an analog way of doing things. Get decent pens. If you're artistic, go for it. I am not. And yet I can still bullet journal because it's just writing into symbols and things. But I keep a diary every day. I keep a journal. My diary is not that of a teenage girl. But it has feelings in it, sad face, happy face, because I can track that over time. Because you know what? If you're sad and miserable, you're not very productive. If you're happy, you are. Who are you? I didn't, because I was sad and miserable all the time. I didn't think about such things. I also have a big wall in my house for all my personal projects are on a post-it note Kanban board. So a Kanban board is something that anybody who's into agile stuff knows. It's this big information radiator. You've got columns like to-do, backlog, in progress, and done. And it's all done digitally in most places. And mine is like, take the post-it note and move it over there. Doing something so physical moving of things across really reinforces it in your mind. If you did want to go digital, these days I do almost entirely analog. My work requires me to do digital stuff, but for all my personal projects, they're all kept in notebooks and on big walls. Because that physical activity reinforces my mind positivity and things that I need to do. But Trello's really good. Basecamp's now got a free personal tier. So if you're looking for a really complicated project organization, Basecamp. If you're into like GitHub and things like that, Codebase HQ is like it's a British company, and it's like not evil GitHub. They've got by far the most nicest integration for issue tracking I've seen, and they've had that integration for 10 years. just the rest of you that are not caught up. They can do exception tracking, all sorts of stuff. So if you're a dev and you're looking at Git, doing anything with Git, don't look at code base. They are fantastic. They're the same people who do deploy HQ, ATEC Media. Even though I write out the tasks I must complete today in my diary, I still use Todoist because that keeps me on track. And it keeps reminding me and saying, hey, you have to do this, you have to do this. And then my digital brain is Notion, so if I'm copying and pasting things, I do that in Notion. So how my daily workflow at work looks like, I use just 4 applications, 5 if you include Keynote. This is where it goes a bit more devy. Basically, I have a browser, I have a terminal, I have an IDE, and I have everything else. Browsers, we all know what they look like. One thing that is interesting about browsers, really, that I want to say is that whenever I find something I want to read, I do not read it then. So I click Save Pocket and have it pushed to a service called Pocket. Or if I know I'm going to read lots and lots of things on this site, I will save to Feedly, which has an integration with Pocket. I will then get my tablet in the morning, which is my dedicated reading thing, and the only thing that I have Pocket app on, actually, so that I read on that tablet and only that tablet. That tablet is set up with color contrast that allow me to read it much more easily. So everything goes through this flow. I won't read directly off the web. I just go, right, I'm going to save that to Pocket, push it through, read it that way. I can then reshare it afterwards. In terms of things like iTerm, for the geeks amongst you, I use the really minimal theme, which gives you a nice headless look. For the real font nerds, I use Hack Nerd font, and if it's a ligature, the monoid nerd font, which gives you a really nice ligature set. If you don't know what any of those words are, do not worry, the Zuki one will be happy with it. I also use a bunch of iTerm scripting. In particular, I use iTerm to open up multiple windows to every single server that we have on our WordPress hosting platform. And then, so I can open up with one click and have access to all of the WordPress hosting platform's main hosts. Then I can go Command-Shift-I, I can start typing, and I'm typing into every single one of them. So when I type in sudo rm-rf backslash and hit enter, I can destroy everything. Won't do that. On my terminals themselves, I always use ZSH. They're default in Macs anyway. Combine this with ZSH. Again, for people who are slightly nerdy, I use Spaceship Theme. In terms of plugins on there, I keep it really low because I... you don't want to. Every time you add a plugin on ZSH, it really does slap things down. So you can see I have virtually nothing on there, other than really the Git integration, which is the important one, and colorize, which gives you beautiful colored output for your ls commands. My editor of choice is Gano. Half the room who are devs and geeks went, it's not a file. It's like, no, I was grown up in them. I'm an old person, so I use Nano. You can come find me afterwards, but please don't. In terms of Atom, Atom's my IDE. I can't show you my whole setup because I can't work on a widescreen. So there's lots of bits, but the Kodi bits in the middle, and file structure over here, and I have a browser built into it, so I don't need to bother to go to a different browser because that takes time. And I also have a terminal window down here. All the bits of use Visual Studio Code, all of that works pretty much the same way. One thing I really like about Atom is that you can use it as a proper IDE. So some of the plugins that I do use, Atom Unify instantly fixes all my code. Just makes it look nice. All the indentations got solved. Bunching the IDE bits in there. If you can get this with both Visual Code and Atom. Bracket colorizer. All it does is it changes the color of the brackets internally for each one. So you can go, oh, that's in that block of code because that's green and that one's red and that one's yellow. As geeky as that sounds, that will probably take you hours. Rest of it, blah, 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 blah. Highlight the silent bits over there. Basically, overly customize my IDE and under customize my terminals because I need to keep them as quiet as possible. Wavebox is a tool that just allows me to integrate Slack, Telegram, Todoist, Trello, Notion, all into one application. The great thing about this is I go, click, gone. Turn this off. What I do with browsers is I also have a host file that I have a single command that says distrap3, which I use with Alfred, which is 3 per second, and it changes my host file to block out about 32,000 websites, which is malware and a bunch of other stuff as well. 32,000 websites I can no longer access. It has every variation of a social media platform you could ever come up with, except for TweetDeck, because I need to use that for work. But I can set TweetDeck up in Wavebox, with we're not allowed to go in it, except to post things through. It won't show me the columns. It blurs them out for me. Alfred, if you haven't used it, if you're a Mac user, my colleague my colleague Keith does a really good Alfred talk, but it really will change your life. It allows you to do snippets and fast snippets, so I can do things like FLF, bracket through, bump, there we go. I'm going for 40 minutes, not 30. Is that okay? Perfect. No, you don't want to ask me questions. I just thought I'd tell her now before she starts panicking. So snippets, I can just go type FLF and then a special character, and it spews out this whole line of code that allows me to find large files on a server. It just gives a DU and the whole path that I want to go to. If I'm doing any real data CLI, it's just WPTL square bracket. We'll also expand that out to JP plugin list. Off it goes. If you're using Windows, the Windows one is ask something. Any of you remember as far as ask. But there's the equivalent for Windows is ask something. And if you're, which I think should be just the summary statement for Windows. And there's also text expander as well. The really cool thing about Alfred, those workflows, allows you to build out complete scripts and systems to do stuff. And for Alfred itself, if you can specify a hotkey, brings up a little search box, and you can write your own search indexing. So in my case, I can write it and say, I want to remember the thing, blah, 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 blah. And because I use Notion for tracking notes digitally, I have certain websites that I always go to set up. I can have a customized search engine that is effectively my second brain. Which is good, because my first one is rubbish. So this is a much better idea if I make sure I keep that as digital as possible. The final section is learning. To improve myself and get that optimization, I need to start learning things to take shortcuts. And there are a few ways that when you get to a certain age, learning's harder. It is actually mentally harder. You're running out of brain cells. They are actually dying. So learning and storing things becomes harder and harder. Likewise, the difference between a senior and a junior dev is the speed they can Google. So realistically, I don't need to learn anything. I just need to learn how to Google it. And to a certain extent, that's what I've done. But there is a little part of me that does need to have at least some memory recall so I can tell you lots about it. Which is why I come and give talks. It's not because I'm an expert in every subject known to man, just a few, but it's not because I'm an expert in subjects, but by researching, by doing talks, and by teaching other people, I have to be able to put them into words and put things into context that they can understand. Which means I slightly understand it myself. Maybe not fully. I can probably bullshit my way through most of it, but I can try. And so learning, to learn, I teach other people. And if I can teach somebody else and they go, I understand this, I probably know it well enough. I also write it down. Whether it's writing blog posts, whether it's writing notes, if I want to remember something, I write it out, and I write it out in long form. If I don't care whether I remember it, I write it in shorthand. Because I can't read any of my writing. I can't read it in long form. I'm just working on hoping that I can make out enough characters. When it comes to shorthand stuff that I write, I have no recollection half the time of what I actually meant. If you see a blog post on my site and it says something like, today I went and did this, that isn't me being kind to you. That's me going, I need to remember this. I need to put it somewhere where somebody else can remind me where it is. And then, I can, when I go and Google it, if I find myself, I know it's the right answer. It was the right answer. Finally, I used flashcards. How many people went to uni and had little, wrote out cards on notes and you would go and ask, you'd have like friends and you'd show, what's this one? Anchor? I don't know if I actually have to say this out loud. This word is basically a digital form of flashcards. You set it up on your computer, and I've had to delay it on this one, and every so often, it will just ping up and say, ask me a question and I have to write the answer. I use this for doing terminal bits. So if I need to learn a new terminal command, I will put in Dankai, how do you change directories in a folder? Okay, it's in the whatever folder I'm going to. That's easy. But I can get it, I can ask these questions, make myself type it in, till it becomes muscle memory. The final bit of all of the puzzle is feeding myself back. How do I know I'm doing better? Well, I monitor, iterate, and monitor. So everything I do, I at least take stock in my mind, but ideally I write down how well I've done what I've done. It means I track everything. Not toilet habits, but close to everything I do. I use an application called Harvest. It's really expensive unless you happen to be doing just one project. So I have a project called Life. It's gone over budget. Because Harvest lets you track by time and money. It's gone way over budget. Should have another one called Daughter. No, actually, I don't want to track that. I make small changes. I tried making big sweeping things. It went brilliantly for 2 weeks. And then I burnt and crashed. Big ball. If you make tiny incremental changes, say you're not a morning person, but you want to get up at, you like the idea of getting up at 5. You probably want to be a morning person. You can start at 7. Wait at 6:30. 5. Go backwards slowly but surely over weeks and weeks. You want to learn something, just repeat it over and over and over again. And small changes really do make a difference and do change your life. So, I hope you've learned something. I'm not sure if you have, if nothing else you've learned, that I'm a very strange person. And I get up very early. And also, you also probably learned that I'm about to go to bed. Anyway, there's an extra slide. That's me saying don't obsess about things. But no, you should just obsess incessantly. But seriously, don't obsess. Just make those little changes. Don't worry about it. I mean, monitor everything. So this is all completely contradictory advice. But if you're starting to get to the point where you're worrying about the things you're doing this wrong. Life's about enjoying things and going forward and finding more time. If you're starting to worry about things, you're then taking up time worrying, and this becomes a self-defeating thing. So don't obsess about any of this. If it's not working for you, go watch that show on Netflix. Thank you very much. What that white bar is up there, which is rather alarmingly on my screen.
Well,
we're looking at
that one question.
Oh, it's the HDMI port. Okay. Thank you. What?
How do you work on the train? like seriously, it's like, I mean, I know Northern Rail is...
No, Trans-Pennine, it's even worse.
Okay, I know Trans-Pennine Rail. How do you do it?
So, I'm a horrible, miserable, looking person. My natural face is raging bad person. You know, I can't even look at somebody in the morning and they think, oh, no, they go, which means I normally get a table to myself. I optimise most of my train journey. I know where the train is going to stop. I know which carriage has reserved seats in it. I know which carriages don't have reserved seats. I know that if I get on the train and I go to the left-hand side, most people go to the right-hand side. I know that there's a table on the train in the morning that has they've set it up so that you can reserve the seat ahead of time by texting. I also know that service doesn't work on that particular train. I always know that those seats are going to be used free because there's a reserve sign on them, but nobody's ever going to sit in them, so I can sit in them safely. I make sure I have tasks that don't require me to use the internet. If I have tasks that do require me to use the internet, I try to break down the blocks to the smallest thing possible and skip over the bits that I can't do. If I have to arrive at work and there are sections of my code that says to do this loop, then I have that. I don't mind train journeys. Headphones on, but basically you look as grumpy as anything. A life hack that one of my friends taught me, if you're doing really long train journeys, is to get a bottle of white lightning, pour it out, fill it with water, and sit on the train. You will have the most peaceful train journey you've ever had, as no one will approach you.